till I am a soul on fire. God, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways. I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. Till I am a soul on fire. Lord, restore the joy I had. I have wandered, bring me back. In this darkness, lead me through until all I see is you. Yeah, God, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways. I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. Till I am a soul on fire. Lord, let me burn for you again. Let me return to you again. Lord, let me burn for you again. Let me return. I'm running for your heart till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways. I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. God, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart till I am a soul on fire. Till I am a soul on fire.
Well, good morning. My name is Pastor Jisuk Ju. I want to welcome all of you to this Pentecost Sunday worship service online. And I hope that the same spirit that came upon this 120 believers 2,000 years ago, the same spirit that will come upon us today. Fill all of us, our hearts and minds and our soul with joy and excitement as we worship the Lord. Again, thanks for joining us in worship online. Well, I have a quick announcement. Next Sunday, we're going to be celebrating Children's Sunday. Children's Sunday, yes, we are all God's children. I'm not talking about adult children, okay? I'm talking about young, little children. We're going to celebrate Children's Sunday. I want all of you guys to mark all on your calendar. So please send the pictures of your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren to our church at amy@fumcvc.com. And we're going to have a slideshow and honor all the children. But that's not it. But next Sunday, we're going to also celebrate the Holy Communion. You can always have a piece of bread or cup of juice ready and to celebrate in your house. But also, we're going to offer a drive-through Holy Communion. All right? Drive-through Holy Communion in our church parking lot. So you can come as soon as the service is over, 10:50, come to our church. And you'll be able to receive the Holy Communion disposable, the Holy Communion, germ-free. And also, but that's not it. Children, I want you guys to pay attention. There will be a breezy snow cones, you know, ready for you. And also balloons made by Ara, you know, flowers and animals and sword. You know, we'll have a lot of fun time together. So mark your calendar next Sunday, June the 7th, from 11 to noon. Our staff will be in our parking lot ready to greet you and have a great time. All right, that's my announcement. And rest of the announcements, please read it. The email that you receive every Sunday, FUMCVC going on, and you'll find other announcements as well. Thank you. Please join me in singing our first hymn, We Are the Church, in your hymnal 558. Good morning, boys and girls. Look what I've got. It's a birthday cake, big one, isn't it? Wow. So, whose birthday is it today? Is anybody's birthday? Is Pastor G's birthday? No, my Pastor G's birthday is in February. Well, you know what? Today is actually Pentecost. You guys repeat after me. Pentecost Sunday, all right? And it's the day... it's the birthday of the Christian church. Well, it's a very special, you know, festival day, just like a Christmas or Easter. You know, on Christmas Day, what do we celebrate? We celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. What about the Easter? What do we celebrate? We celebrate the risen Christ. Jesus is raised from the dead. And then Pentecost, we celebrate the birthday of the church. You know, the early believers, you know, they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and then they go out and be witnesses. They share the good news of Jesus Christ with people, not only within their area, but also to the ends of the earth. Since, you know, we are all churches made up of the people, you know, who worship God, you know, we are celebrating this Pentecost, the birthday of the church today. I want you to join me in singing Happy Birthday, will you? All right, here we go. 1, 2, 3. Happy birthday to church. Happy birthday to church. Happy birthday, dear church. Happy birthday to church. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you so much for this Pentecost Sunday. Reminds us of the birthday of the early Christian church. Help us to remember that those believers were filled with the Holy Spirit and share the good news of Jesus Christ. We want to be like that too, Lord. Be witnesses for Jesus Christ with our friends and our families and neighbors. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Today, we are also celebrating Confirmation Sunday. You will see those 18 young men and women who have spent for the last 4 months for intense study, prayer, and the hard work. Bryant, our youth director, and myself, you know, did our best, try to help them to understand what it means to be a Christian and what it means to be a member of the United Methodist Church. And they were given an opportunity to profess their faith and to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And they commit themselves to live for Jesus. So since this coronavirus, you know, guidelines and restrictions, we're not able to hold the ceremony together. So we pre-recorded last Wednesday. All right, so we're gonna watch the slideshow and let us congratulate those 18 young and men and women who went through this confirmation class. Let's watch.
Hey everyone, I'm Bryant. I just want to recap the confirmation journey we just finished. We started in the high school Sunday school classroom way back in the month of February, and our confirmation journey got interrupted by the virus, which you all know of, and we ended up taking about a month off. But the last 5 weeks, we were able to finish our confirmation journey on Zoom, and it was so great to be able to finish, and what an awesome journey it was. We're not only celebrating all these students today, but I am anticipating what God's going to do in their life in the future. Thank you so much. Help me celebrate these awesome students, and the best is yet to come.
Confirmation has helped me grow in my faith because it's taught me how to know God through the Bible and how to pray properly. Confirmation has really grown in faith for me because I really got closer to God more.
So I've grown in faith through confirmation first it used to just be I'd just go to Sunday school and we'd learn about the stories, but confirmation has helped like really take an in-depth look at what Christianity and the Methodist Church is all about.
Confirmation was a great journey for me. I've got to grow deeper in Christ, and I've become a greater follower of Jesus, and I want to thank you guys for everything that you've done for us.
Confirmation showed me how to love God more. Just shows me how to respect Him and how to love Him.
Through confirmation, I learned the deeper meanings behind some of the more prominent stories in the Bible.
I got closer to God, and I got more serious about God and Jesus and Jesus Christ.
Through confirmation, I learned a whole bunch of new stories through the Bibles and made some new friends through confirmation.
Through confirmation, I learned that no matter what happens, God will be there with you.
Through confirmation, I have learned to grow my trust in Jesus and through the Methodist Church.
In confirmation, I felt like I got closer to God and Jesus, and I also felt like I got closer to the Bible and all the scriptures.
I've gotten a lot closer to God, and I've been able to read my Bible a lot more.
I learned to be closer to God and more about our church history and more about our Bible.
Through confirmation, I've learned more about Jesus, and I get to get closer with Him every time I come to class.
Through classes, I learned more about God and got closer to Him by learning the history of Methodism.
Through confirmation, I have enjoyed learning about God and the church.
I felt like over the past couple months, I have learned more about my religion, and therefore I felt like I've been closer to God more than I ever have, and I have a better understanding of what it means to be a Methodist, and I'm happy that I took confirmation.
During confirmation, I feel I learned more about my faith and the history of my religion and what it means to be a true Methodist, and I am happy to be a confirmed Christian.
During confirmation class, I've learned that I have grown closer to God, and I've learned more about the United Methodist Church and how it's been formed, and how the struggles we've gone through, but in the end, I've learned I'm closer to God.
Thank you.
Let's pray, especially let's pray for those 18 young men and women who commit themselves to give their lives for Christ. Lord, on this Pentecost Sunday, we ask you to send your Holy Spirit to touch the heart of all those 18 confirmants so that they will more firmly believe in you and in Jesus whom you sent. Continue to look upon all these young men and women as they listen to your voice in their lives. Open their hearts to your Spirit and bring to fulfillment the good work that you have begun in them. Make each of them an instrument of your love. Love for you and love for their neighbors. Deepen their faith in the gospel and help us to pass it on by our example. We pray that you will continue to guide them and sustain them. Please continue to pray for our brothers and sisters in our church family, their family members, their friends. Judy Dellinger, she's recovering from her knee, left knee fracture. And Tyler Elpress, the Tony and Olivia's son-in-law, he suffers the polycystic kidney disease and waiting for the kidney transplant. And let's pray for Jim Waller and Don Bennett, who are diagnosed with the prostate cancer and currently going through treatments and waiting for the treatments in the upcoming days. Please keep them in your prayers. And lastly, let us pray for this injustice tragedy that happened in Minnesota this past week. We were brokenhearted and deeply grieved when we saw an African-American man, George Floyd, whose life was taken by other human beings. Let us pray for comfort for his grieving families and friends, and pray for this peace and justice for hurting communities, and pray for the communities that are planning to have the protest around the United States over this weekend. Let's pray. God of Pentecost, we thank you for the pouring out of your Holy Spirit upon us, your church, upon each and every one of us this morning. We thank you for the fire of your Spirit that opens our eyes to the fires of injustice that are all around us. We pray for the family of the George Floyd, who died unjustly, and his families and friends, the whole United States, are grieving over the loss of their loved one. Be with everyone who was traumatized and brokenhearted by the event. We pray for many cities and many neighborhoods, for the people on the front lines of the protest and conflict, and for all those whose lives have been impacted by this event. We pray for Minnesota State and local leaders as they respond to the situation. Almighty God, on this day, through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you reveal the way of eternal life to every race and nation. Pour out this gift anew that by this preaching of the gospel, your salvation may reach you to the ends of the earth. Almighty God, you created us in your own image. Grant us grace to contend fearlessly against evil and to make no peace with oppression. Help us to use our freedom rightly in the establishments of justice in our communities and among the nations to the glory of your holy name. Lord, we pray on this Pentecost Sunday for those who are grieving the loss of their loved one. May the fire of your Spirit warm their hearts. We pray for those who are facing medical tests or waiting for kidney transplant, or battling with cancers, or recovering from knee fracture, or feeling weak, and we name them before the Lord. Judy Dellinger, Tyler Auspress, Jim Waller, Don Bennett, Betty James, Bruce Campbell. May the fire of your spirit warm their hearts. For those who are in need of physical, emotion, relational, or spiritual healing in their lives, may the fire of your spirit warm their hearts. We pray for those who are on the front line dealing with coronavirus daily. May the fire of your spirit protect them and warm their hearts. We pray for those who are feeling lonely or discouraged. May the fire of your spirit warm their hearts. On this Pentecost Sunday, warm all of our hearts, O God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 13. When the day of the Pentecost came, all the believers gathered in one place. Suddenly a sound came from heaven. It was like a strong wind blowing. It filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw something that looked like the shape of fire, looked like fire in the shape of tongues. The flames separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. They began speaking languages they had not known before. The Spirit had gave them the ability to do this. Godly Jews from every country in the world were staying in Jerusalem. A crowd came together where they had heard the sound. They were bewildered because each of them had heard their own language being spoken. The crowd was really amazed. They asked, "Aren't all of these people who are speaking Galileans? Then why do we hear them speaking our own language? We are Parthians, Medes, and Elamites." But some of the people in the crowd made fun of the believers. They've had too much wine, they said.
Thank you.
Today, we're continuing on a sermon series on the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Today's text comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. And now, you can tell that, you know, Jesus actually instructed the people, these 120 believers and 11 disciples, to stay in Jerusalem until they will receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then the gift of the power of the Holy Spirit. Then they will receive the power. And then, you know, be witnesses for Jesus Christ, not only in Jerusalem, but also in all the Judea and the Samaria to the ends of the earth. That's what we've been talking about for the last couple of Sundays. You know, Jesus, the disciples were gathering in Jerusalem, waiting as Jesus ascends into heaven to be with the Father, and he promised to come back. Well, God has chosen to come down on the day of Pentecost. So what is Pentecost? Well, Pentecost is actually the Greek word, Pentecostos. Pentecostos meaning 50. 50, you know, it was used by the Greek-speaking Jews, you know, as the phrase to refer to a Jewish holiday known as the Festival of Wheat. Festival of Wheat. So, you know, the according to the book of Leviticus, chapter 23, God instructed, you know, the Israelite, his people, that for the 50 days, for the 7 weeks after the Passover, they are to have a celebration of this harvest worship and give thanks to the Lord. And afterwards, over the time, you know, this was used as they commemorate the giving of the law on Mount Sinai. That's a little background information I'd like to give you before we go into today's scripture. So the Holy Spirit, you know, comes on the day of Pentecost. The Spirit of God comes on the day of Pentecost. Then what happened? What happened 2,000 years ago in the upper room? You know, the scripture says when the Holy Spirit came, it sounded like a mighty rushing wind. But it wasn't really a wind. It wasn't really a wind. You know, the author of this book of Acts, the Luke, is trying his best to describe what's happening to those people in the upper room. You know, the wind, you know, yes, the Holy Spirit came. The Holy Spirit came and it sounded like a mighty rushing wind, but it was not really wind. The sound is so loud that the people outside his house, they began to gather. What's going on? What's this sound? But here's the thing. Even though it sounded like a mighty rushing wind, you know, the furniture in the upper room were not moving. You know, people's hair in the upper room is not blowing back and forth. Their clothing is not really moving. I mean, think about it. If this, you know, mighty rushing wind, then the fire, tongues of fires on their head must be, you know, went out, right? But it's still on. So it was a sound, probably like this. Not really a sound, not really a wind, but the sound of the wind. And also the scripture says, you know, divided tongues of fire, you know, appeared and then rested on each one of them. Again, if it's a real fire, then their head hair must be burned, but it wasn't a real physical fire, right? It's something supernatural. So Luke is trying to describe what's happening to those 100 believers in the upper room. And there are many symbolic applications that people talk about. And I hear one person say, you know, the winds that blows in the upper room, it's like a kite. Do you guys know kite? Kite, you know, that has no life on the ground. And it's not moving. But when the wind begins to blow, what happened? This kind of wind is strong. You know, the kite, you know, all of a sudden picks up, soar up in the air, and floats with the air. And then what? You know, you pull it, and then actually the kite kind of dancing, isn't it? Shh, right? You have seen it. Your children, your grandchildren still fly the kite. It's so much fun, isn't it? Well, you know, I like this kind of analogy because we all like to dance, right? And we want the Holy Spirit to come inside of us like a wind so that, you know, they give us a joy and a power. But again, you know, the scripture says it was not really breeze. It sounded like a mighty rushing wind, but there's no really wind. And then divided tongues like a fire. I heard one person say, you know, it's the fire that gives warmth and the light. Well, I like this analogy too, because we all like to feeling of the warmth, right? And we need the light to see in the darkness. But again, it was not a real physical light, physical warmth. However, what I see here is that this burning thing on each one of their heads makes me to think about this burning bush described in the Old Testament, the book of Exodus chapter 3. You remember in Exodus chapter 3, you know, Moses encounters God. You know, there was this bush burning. There's a bush on the fire, but it was not really consumed. It was not really being burned. So what does this burning bush represent? It represents the manifestation of the presence of God. You know, when God led his people through the wilderness for 40 years, how did God lead them? God led them, you know, with a pillar of cloud by day and, you know, with a pillar of fire by night. You see this, you know, fire on their head. You know, for the people of Israel, it's the manifestation of the presence of God. And that makes me to think, okay, that fire that rested upon the people, probably, you know, God is telling them, you know what? You know, I will be with you. No matter where you go from now on, you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. You, no matter what circumstances you are in, no matter what kind of hardships and difficulties and persecutions you go through, you know, remember, I will be with you. That's the great news for us on this Pentecost Sunday. As we go through very difficult time with this pandemic, COVID-19, God promises us, you know, I'm sending you the Holy Spirit with the wind, with this, you know, divided tongues of fire on your head. I'm promising you that I'll be with you. That's the words of encouragement, isn't it? I give thanks God for that. But I'd like to share with you my own analogy. My own analogy of the Holy Spirit. Okay? I share with you a couple of them from other people, but this is my analogy. You guys see very often nowadays, What's this? Dandelion. Do you guys see often, right, on your grass in front of your houses or other parks, right? And we pick it up and then blow it. Should I blow? Woo! What do you think? I'm gonna have to vacuum it after this. But well, I don't know about you, but it's just amazing. I mean, God is so intentional, you know, in creating of the human being, but also I can tell that God is so creative, intentional in creating of these plants. I mean, the only way this dandelion scatters and the seed is through what? Wind. Right? Wind. I mean, if you look at this upper part, I'll show you on the video, okay? You can see it from here, but then upper part is so much, there are devices that helps float, that helps to float this, you know, each seed. It looks like a parachute. And then the bottom part is actually the seed. The only way this dandelion to reproduce or the multiply is through the wind. It must be carried by the wind, right? Yes. So, you know, as I was meditating upon the scripture this morning and looking at this God's creation, dandelion makes me to think, okay? You know, God is blowing his, you know, winds right now in this totally different times, totally different changes, okay? He's blowing airs, his Holy Spirit on us. You know, he's asking you and me, especially those, your confirmation, those young women and, you know, men, we are all, you know, called to be the church. We are blown by this wind, the Holy Spirit. What do? We can't stay here. We have to go. We have to scatter into the community, into our neighbors, into our families, into our schools, and into, you know, our workplaces, and be the church. That's kind of image that I think of whenever I think about this, the power of the Holy Spirit. God is calling you and me, First United Methodist Church, brothers and sisters, to be the church. Even though the church buildings shut down, closed, but you know what? God's mission continues. Even though church might be restricted for you to come in, you be able to come into the church, but you know what? God's mission continues through you. Holy Spirit, you know, the winds of the Holy Spirit is blowing on you right now. We got to be scattered into the community and be the church. And as the divine tongues of fire rested upon them, it's upon with us. Tells us that God will be with us. And hope and pray that, you know, you will experience that. The power of the Holy Spirit today. And be the witnesses for Jesus Christ in whatever forms they may be. Amen. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you for this Pentecost Sunday, for sending your Holy Spirit, you know, upon us, each and every one of us. We are filled, we are baptized with the Holy Spirit this morning. This, you know, it came, it sounded like a mighty rushing wind, and then divide tongues of fire that tells us that we are called to be the church, scatters into the community, and you promise that you will be with us. Lord, help us continue to be the church and witnessing for Jesus Christ wherever we may be. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Tomorrow brings, with each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
On behalf of the First United Methodist Church of Valley Center, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your continued support your church financially. That means a lot. Thank you. Your tithe, your offering, your donation really help us to do the works that God has given us to do. Please consider helping out and giving it today. You can always write a check and mail it to our church. Or you can visit our website, www.fumcvc.org, and you'll find this upper part that says give. Just click that one, and you'll find the instruction. Follow the instruction, and you'll be able to give online. Your donation, your tithes and offerings will be greatly appreciated as we continue to expand your kingdom. Brothers and sisters in Christ, do you feel the power of the Holy Spirit were given to you this morning? Do you feel the joy and excitement and the power the Spirit is giving you? Let us remember, you know, we are called to be the church. We are called to be scattering not into this community, to our homes and to our schools and workplaces and neighbors. Be the church and share the love of Christ with everyone we meet. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, communion, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with all of us today, this week, and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.